United States Army presents The Big Picture, an official report produced for the armed forces and the American people. Now, to show you part of the big picture, here is Sergeant Stuart Queen.
Modern Army aviation is today a highly specialized field. The pilots who fly the Army aircraft have been carefully trained in many skills over and above piloting. The aircraft have each been designed to do a particular job, and to do it well. For no one type of aircraft can be universal in its application. Some of these aircraft carry airborne troops, as, for example, the Caribou. Some are designed for fast, low-level observation and reconnaissance missions. But they all have a common denominator in that they all come from a common source. The picture you will see today is part one of a three-part series. This portion takes us back to the very beginning of aviation at Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. Part two, which you will see next week, takes this story on from General Billy Mitchell era up to the present. Part three will show you how the United States Army has utilized all of the progress in the aviation field to create highly specialized aircraft in order to perform its global mission. And now, part one of the history of aviation.
On December 17, 1903, Orville and Wilbur Wright made man's first four controlled flights in a powered airplane. That day, they lifted the world into a new dimension. What the Wrights had achieved at Kitty Hawk barely evoked passing attention in a nation whose people were absorbed with the problems of a dynamic new age. There were other less celestial wonders closer at hand. The automobile, the telephone, the motion picture. But at number 7 Hawthorne Street, December 17, 1903 was a momentous day. The young girl who was then the Wrights' housekeeper, Carrie Grumbach, remembers.
I remember the telegram when it come, that they had flown.
The telegram from Kitty Hawk had a special significance for the mechanic who worked in the Wrights' bicycle shop, Charlie Taylor.
I made all the different parts in the motor. I even made the crankshaft. So I made it out of a solid block of steel, about 32 inches long, 6 inches wide, and inch and 5/8 thick. The motor itself, from the time I started, well, I had it ready for test, was 6 weeks. 50 years ago, I can remember as though it was yesterday almost.
There was not a complete indifference to the Wrights' discovery. A small group of Americans were laboring to further the art. And in Europe, where the airplane's military potential was quickly realized, a fresh wave of enthusiasm for aviation followed the Wrights' success. In France, Blériot, Farman, and Briquet were flying airplanes of their own design. The Englishman Curie and the Brazilian Santos Dumont, most of whose experiments took place in France, also captured the imagination of Europe with successful flights. The Wrights had offered to demonstrate their airplane to the United States Army shortly after their first successful flights. The Army declined, preferring to develop its small fleet of balloons as an air arm. Oddly, it was a young balloonist lieutenant of the Army who finally was instrumental in obtaining a chance for the Wrights and their airplane, Frank P. Long.
After 4 long years of failing to recognize the Wrights, finally, in December of 1907, the Board of Ordnance and Fortifications granted an interview to Wilbur. At once, he inspired their confidence. This led to a contract in February of 1908 between the Wright brothers and the Signal Corps, in which they agreed to furnish an airplane that would fly 40 miles an hour, carry 2 persons, remain in the air for 1 hour, and, strange to relate, was to have some kind of a device by which, in case the motor stopped, it could be landed without crashing. In the summer of 1908, Orville Wright brought to Fort Myer, Virginia, the airplane that was to fulfill the specifications of the contract. Day after day, we watched him fly around and around the field in his tuning up flights, And finally, on the 9th of September, he broke the world's record by staying in the air for over 1 hour.
Another young Army lieutenant, Benjamin Foloi, had a chance to fly in the Wright plane at Fort Myer.
On the day following the endurance test with Orville Wright and Lieutenant Lam, the Orville, with a quiet little grin on his face, invited me to be his guest on the crucial and final cross-country and speed test. On July 30th, we took off on the final cross-country and speed test. Shortly after we straightened out on the course for Alexandria, Orville, with this same little grin on his face, told me that if he had to land anywhere on the route, and he'd pick out the thickest clump of trees he could find and land on top of them. Fortunately, the little engine that we had at the time carried us all the way through without any difficulty. And we finally landed back at Fort Myer Drill Ground with three world records, cross country, 10 miles, altitude 600 feet, and speed 42 and a half miles an hour.
The United States Army had an airplane. The need now was for pilots.
There in the fall of 1909, under Wilbur Wright's instruction, Lieutenant F. E. Humphreys of U.S. Engineers and myself were taught to fly, and at the end of some 3 hours, were soloed and told we were pilots.
So in 1909, the military airplane was mated to the military pilot. Meanwhile, all over the world, aviation pioneers, encouraged by the Wright brothers' flights, were hard at work. The principles of flight were now widely known, and designers were applying them to many types of aircraft. Glenn Curtis, Glenn Martin, and the Canadian J.A.D. McCurdy were designing and flying airplanes in competition and for exhibition. In Europe, the airplanes of Blériot, Paulhan, Farman, and de Havilland were demonstrating obvious advances in both speed and range. And in Russia, Igor Sikorsky was taking his first steps into the age of flight.
And I remember very, very well the early interesting period in France in 1909 and 1910, when the very first attempts were made to push aviation from the purely original experimental flying to some kind of successful practical achievement. I have seen Blériot coming in the same factory to purchase his motor, on which a few months later he crossed the English Channel. And at that time, I had my share of failures with the first helicopter, which was a fine machine, only it couldn't fly.
Glenn Martin remembers an episode of his pioneering days.
I've just been reading an old postcard sent by our family doctor to my mother, dated September 30th, 1910. This is at a time when I just began to leave the ground in a flying machine. And it says, "For heaven's sake, if you have any influence with that wild-eyed, hallucinated young man, call him off before he is killed. Have him devote his energies to substantial, feasible, and profitable pursuits, leaving dreaming to the professional dreamers."
For a dreamer, Glenn Martin was attracting a remarkable group of clear-thinking young designers as workmen. The first to join him was Donald Douglas.
My first memory of things in aviation was seeing the first Wright airplane demonstrated for the Signal Corps in 1908 at Fort Myers, outside of Washington. So I took the streetcar and one thing and another and got out to Fort Myers. Well, there she was, as I had seen her pictured, the old Wright pusher. And there were Wilbur and Orville. And there was that old launching device that kind of looked like a guillotine, and they had the airplane perched up at the starting part of the track and the weight all ready to go. And then, as I recall, it was Wilbur that got into the machine with, I guess it was Colonel Lam, and they pulled the old latch. And off she went.
One of the first pilots was Roy Nabenshue, who was a balloonist even before he became an airplane pilot.
Gentlemen, I'm pointing out, right back of the pilot was Walter Brookins. Walter was a great pilot. His judgment was uncanny, but he was very temperamental. As a matter of fact, he, Arch Hoxie, and Ralph Johnson was the three best pilots that the Wright Company had, and each one tried to outdo the other.
The ambitions of some designers went far beyond their skills. As Igor Sikorsky has said,
in the history of aviation, there have been many contraptions which, to the good fortune of their inventors, failed to fly.
Sperry, whose contributions to the aircraft instrument field were momentous, puts a pre-war aircraft through its paces. All this ferment, however often it seemed to lack direction, was contributing in one way or another to the growth of aviation. The airplane was growing cleaner in design. Its horsepower was more dependable. The disparaging term aeronaut was giving way to aviator, a term of respect. Aviation was emerging as a science. A pioneer aeronautical engineer and educator, Dr. Jerome Hunsaker.
Professional education in aeronautical engineering began in this country at MIT in the winter of 1913-14. This course was started by President McLaurin, borrowing me from the Navy Department and supplying me with one assistant as staff, who was a recent graduate in mechanical engineering, Donald Douglas, from whom more was to be heard.
The pusher engine of early planes had been replaced by the tractor engine installations, which allowed higher speeds. The Wrights were foreseeing these helpful aircraft devices, and other inventors, such as Elmer Sperry, were inventing and refining them. Here, a Curtiss seaplane flies with the early Sperry automatic pilot. Almost without exception, in the first decade of the airplane, the designers were pilots. They built, tested, and flew their own designs. The Wrights, Blériot, Santos Dumont, Curtiss, Rowe, Sikorsky, de Havilland, and Martin. At Glen Martin's, a band of engineers and craftsmen had gathered together whose names and time would be synonymous with aircraft designs of world rank. Donald Douglas, James H. Dutch Kindleberger, Lawrence Larry Bell, Alan Lockheed, John Northrop. The United States was the cradle of flight. Inventors of a high order had appeared. Our pilots were unmatched. First-rate designers emerged. Brilliant men specialized in the components of the airplane. But as a pioneer who specialized in aircraft horsepower, Frederick B. Rentschler summarizes.
Prior to World War I, our most important contribution to aviation was the flight of the Wright brothers.
From December 1909 to March 1911, 13 months, the entire United States Air Force consisted of one officer, myself, one civilian mechanic, 8 enlisted men, 1 airplane. The government at that time wasn't very keen about turning money loose for flying. I had the great appropriation of $150 allotted to me to take care of the airplane for the entire year 1910.
Two air-minded young lieutenants shortly joined General Foloy, the one-man Air Force. They were Hap Arnold and T. DeWitt Milling.
Looking back 42 years ago to March 1911, The month in which General Arnold and myself were ordered to Dayton to learn to fly with the Wright brothers, and to think of the plane that we used at that time and see the advance that has been made since, it seems incomprehensible that one man in his own lifetime could live through such progress. After our very brief period of instruction, of about a week, 2 to 3 hours in order to learn to fly, we were sent to College Park, Maryland. We immediately started in to try to find some method by which we could develop, from the standpoint of taking photographs, using the machine gun, dropping bombs.
The air arm of the United States Navy began under equally apathetic circumstances. Naval aviator number 3 was Admiral John H. Towers.
In the autumn of 1911, when I was quite a young naval officer serving aboard one of our battleships, I got the idea that I wanted to learn to fly, that naval aviation would amount to something for naval purposes. So I put in a request to the Navy Department, and they came back and quite frankly said that they didn't believe aviation would ever amount to anything. But if it turned out to be otherwise, they would consider my request. During that winter, Congress appropriated money for the Navy to buy 3 airplanes. So they were in it whether or not they wanted to be. And then they decided to select 3 officers to be taught to fly as part of the contract with the manufacturers of the airplanes. I was fortunate enough to be one of those 3 officers. The other 2 were Ellison and Rogers. I also became a very close friend of Glenn Curtis and was associated with him throughout his whole life. The man had an enormous amount of vision. He had already conducted, in cooperation with the Navy, tests of landing an airplane on a platform, on a cruiser, and also of taking off. But he had in his mind then the idea which later developed into the powerful carriers that we have today.
The airplane now had official recognition, both from the Army and the Navy, but it was a cautious acceptance. The time-forged armament still held sway. When the fledgling Army flyers experimented with a primitive bombsight and a Lewis machine gun, installed an aircraft at College Park, Maryland, they landed and foresaw whole battles that someday might be fought in the air. The War Department promptly pierced that bubble. An official spokesman pointed out with finality that the Army had airplanes for just one purpose, reconnaissance. From a pistol shot at Sarajevo, the first of the great modern world wars exploded. And almost overnight, all of Europe was engulfed in conflict. The airplane was put to work just as the U.S. War Department spokesman had prophesied, as observation and scouting craft. The source of peril lay in the artillery, machine gun, and rifle fire, scourging the entrenched troops from across the wasted land. But in the air, Allied and German pilots often waved to each other as they passed on their observation missions. Then, instead of the courteous wave, the opposing pilots began exchanging pistol fire. Presently, the first crudely mounted machine guns appeared. Now, the frantic race of inventing, improvising, adapting, and refining aircraft equipment began. Quickly, the Germans countered the hand-operated machine gun by installing upon their aircraft the invention of Tony Fokker, a machine gun synchronized to fire through the aircraft propeller. A paramount lesson that the Allies were to remember a generation later was being learned in air warfare for the first time. No design capable of still further development could be frozen. While the single-engined airplane had been engrossing most designers, in Russia, Igor Sikorsky...
In 1912, I decided that the time came to build a large machine with several motors. At that time, I was certain already that the future of aviation will be connected with fairly large aircraft. In 13, I completed my first 4-motored airplane, the Grand. The ship proved a complete success. It flew quite well.
The Grand's military successor, the Ilya Murmets, was the first 4-engine bomber in world history. It struck time after time at the Central Powers on the Eastern Front. The internal combustion engine now became an instrument of intensive technical development. The first successful engine had not been developed until 1860. One of the world's foremost engine designers, Leonard S. Hobbs, recollects its history.
It starts out actually with a little-known Frenchman by the name of Lenoir, who has never gotten the credit he deserved. He built and actually marketed the first internal combustion engine, and it was from his engine that the Wright brothers were able to build one. Of course, the early pre-war power plants are fairly well known, the Anzanis and the Curtiss OXs. The First World War did mark a great advance in power plants. First, there were the rotaries, the Clergés, the Nomerones. Then there was the Renault engine, which was a very good French engine. The British RAF engines. Toward the end of the war came the very beginning of what I think is the modern engine. First, there was the Hispano Suiza with its solid block and a valve arrangement, which is standard in a lot of engines to this day. Also, out of the First World War came a remarkable German effort, the BMW. Now, this engine is the first engine that I know of in all history that attempted to overcome the effects of altitude on power.
Conflict in which European antagonists had been tempered by 3 years of savage battle, whose equipment had been perfected by the necessity of survival without regard to cost, the United States now plunged. It was the world's 14th ranking air power, with only 28 airplanes, 65 pilots, supplemented by 50 flying students. Its Navy combat air arm was even smaller. Its industry lacked integration. The nation that had allotted Benny Folloy $150 in 1910 for maintenance of that year's Air Force promptly voted $600 million to fulfill a plea by the Allies to have 5,000 airplanes and 4,500 pilots on the Western Front by the spring of 1918. Our national mistake was the assumption that an instrument as dynamic as the airplane could be designed, tested, and developed overnight. Thousands of rookie pilots training in the United States and in England and France had an inspiring example of American air combat performance through the brilliant exploits of the Lafayette Escadrille, a team of American volunteers who had joined the Allied cause in 1916. But American performance had its hours of frustration. One of the first young pilots to see action in France with the 1st Aero Squadron was Oliver P. Eccles.
We'd been equipped with a new type of French airplane with a new and very much improved engines. These airplanes were assigned to us. The squadron had the strength of 18 airplanes, and we were assigned the mission of supporting one of the American divisions one afternoon in the attack. Our airplanes took off 18 strong. During the afternoon, all of the airplanes force landed from engine failure. Fortunately, none of them behind the enemy line.
The pilots of World War I made the term dogfight synonymous with their work. America's top ace, Captain Eddie Rickenbacker of the famed 94th Hat in Ring Squadron, reflects on the different approaches to combat of the pilots of World War I and the pilots of today.
That individualism was possible because the planes were much slower. You'd stay in maneuver. Whereas today, it's impossible because of the tremendous speed, the difference of 100 miles an hour and six or 700 miles an hour. We had 150 horsepower. Today, if they haven't got 5,000 or 6,000 horsepower, it's no good. We had two little pop guns, 30 caliber, that would shoot sometimes 450 rounds a minute. Today, they've got 6 and 8 50 caliber guns that'll shoot 1,000 rounds a minute.
A naval officer whose career has bridged two wars in aeronautics, Admiral DeWitt C. Ramsey.
From the outset, the Navy's problem has been to bring aircraft into the mobile operating forces of the fleet. The real beginning of naval aviation, let us say, took place in England where during World War I, the latter part of it, the British converted two ships, the Furious and the Argus, and built into them the features which were desirable for aircraft launching and recovery. As a result, the Navy embarked on an initial program of converting the old Collier Jupiter into our first flat top, the Langley.
In 1918, as the war began to move toward its climax, American aircraft equipment still had not entered combat. An intensive effort was being made to perfect the Liberty engine. Before the Liberty or any other aerial product of the United States designing boards could be put in action, the final critical offensive of World War I had begun. Millions of men pulled out of trenches to attack or retreat. Above them, to be sure, planes flew in bombing and strafing missions. Individual pilots whose names became legendary met in dogfights. Germany's von Richthofen, France's Fonck, Canada's Bishop, Germany's Goering, and such American aces as Rickenbacker, Luke, Lufbery, Vaughan, Springs, Kindley, Landis, Schwab, Hunter.
After the war was over, a great many of American boys had been taught to fly, but they didn't get to the front. Of course, after the war was over, they had nothing to do, and there were a great many surplus airplanes. And that is the period when you hear so much about the days of barnstorming. After the war, with all these surplus airplanes, a lot of the fellows who had been taught to fly then decided to go out and carry passengers and do stunts and regular exhibition flying, principally at county fairs and state fairs and things of that sort.
Both the Army and Navy air arms shortly were reduced once again to organizations hardly larger than the membership of a civic club. Yet in both services, the men who remained were uniquely zealous advocates of their calling. Army pilots already had inaugurated airmail service on May 15, 1918, a service that had been under discussion since 1910. William Boeing, who had entered aviation in 1916, was instrumental in starting the first international airmail service on the North American continent.
In 1919, Eddie Hubbard and I took a flight up to Vancouver, BC. On our return trip, the postmaster at Vancouver handed us a mail sack for delivery to the postmaster at Seattle. This was the first international mail ever carried by plane into the United States.
The Big Picture is an official report for the armed forces and the American people. Produced by the Army Pictorial Center. Presented by the Department of the Army in cooperation with this station. States Army presents The Big Picture, an official report produced for the armed forces and the American people. Now, to show you part of the big picture, here is Sergeant Stuart Queen.
Last week, you saw the beginning of aviation, starting in the fields of Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. Today, we shall see part two of this three-part series, covering the era of General Billy Mitchell through to the supersonic aircraft of today.
Brigadier General William Mitchell, who had had a distinguished war record, argued that the Mahan doctrine of sea power had been outmoded by the airplane and pleaded for a separate national air arm. He contended, in seeking a $60 million appropriation for Army air services, or about half the cost of a single battleship, that the United States could begin developing an air force which could hold mastery of both the air and the seas. Larry Bell was still with Glenn Martin when...
That resulted in Congress bringing about a test wherein one of the targets that we were supposed to sink or try to sink was the famous Oosterfriesland. This ship was anchored about 100 miles offshore, and six of the Martin bombers went out, each carrying a 2,000-pound bomb. They paraded over the battleship, and they dropped the six bombs, and only one hit it, and that was by mistake. The rest were timed to detonate at 100 feet below the surface, and it practically exploded the Oosterfriesland. At least it ripped the bottom of the ship from bow to stern, and the ship sank in 4 minutes.
The nation accepted the airplane and tacitly agreed with its advocates. But there was still no federal provision for long-range planning and procurement. Nevertheless, a corps of designers and manufacturers stayed with the business. In the ceaseless drive to attain longer range and more reliable performance, the airplane, its engine, its components, and its instruments steadily were growing more complex. But the primary goal was speed. Roscoe Turner.
I have maintained ever since that I've been flying that there's only one reason for flying, and that is speed. It's 1910 Curtis, 49 miles an hour. 1910 White, 61 miles an hour. 1911 Wyman, 78 miles an hour. 1920 Mosley, 156 miles an hour. Mon, in 1922, 206 miles an hour. And 1925, Doolittle, 232 miles an hour.
Jimmy Doolittle, a hell-for-leather pilot, whose own cold judgment was that he was essentially a technician.
These record flights have a very real meaning. Competition has perhaps always been the greatest stimulus to improvement.
A great many great men have contributed to aviation purely as specialists. Sperry, one of the greatest. Colonel Clark, who devised one of the first good airfoils. Sam Herron came along on his cylinders and his fuel, and then Frank Mock with his carburation devices and later fuel injection. Frank Caldwell with his propeller.
Our earliest propellers were all wooden propellers, but they had several shortcomings. They were subject to atmospheric troubles, and they twisted out of shape in various climates. And they were also quite thick, so that at the high speed at which propeller tips operated, they were losing efficiency. One of the things which we did to overcome this was to develop a metal propeller, which first was a drop-forged aluminum alloy blade. Being very much thinner than the wooden ones, the efficiency was maintained in better condition.
Sam Herron began working on aircraft engines as early as 1909 and shortly went to the Royal Aircraft Factory in England.
I came to this country in 1921 and for the next 5 years was engaged in air-cooled cylinder development. It was really the air-cooled engine that made fuel development so necessary. The first move was to put tetraethyl lead in the existing gasoline. Later, the Air Force got the idea of adding the component that has the high end of the octane scale to the gasoline, and that eventually led to 100 octane gasoline.
Frank Mock, the carburation and fuel control specialist.
Our carburation work has always had to be a good bit like that of the Wright brothers, in the respect that we could get little guide from a textbook.
The automobile carburetor, of course, was designed to operate on the level. The aircraft carburetors have to climb, dive, even fly upside down. Also, they have to go up an altitude where the air is thin.
Mock, Hobbs, Sperry, Clark, Caldwell, Herron. The singular devotion with which these men and scores of other specialists pursued their particular fields leads H.M. Jack Horner, whose own specialty of aircraft production combined the fruits of all their labors, to say,
that heritage of research, development, the background work that goes into aircraft has continued throughout the whole existence of aircraft and the great improvements that have come there too.
Then, midway in the 20s, came two events that turned the course of American aviation sharply upward. First, the government adopted the recommendations of President Coolidge's Morrow Board. These called for a sustained aircraft procurement program built on the foundation of a privately operated and technically competitive aircraft industry. Although both military airmen and technologists were convinced that the airplane long before had outgrown its function as a scout, the bulk of our aircraft still consisted of observation planes. Now, new, more powerful engines began to emerge for advanced aircraft, which both services had developed. The nation moved rapidly from a third-rate air power to international leadership. The second event was the successful dream Charles Lindbergh made come true. In his single-engine Ryan monoplane, Lindbergh had flown the Atlantic nonstop to Paris. 2 weeks later, carrying Charles Levine as a passenger, Clarence Chamberlain flew the Atlantic and landed in Germany.
First of all, we were trying to beat Lindbergh away. And second, we had to keep our plans a deep, dark secret because we had overheard Mrs. Levine say, if I thought my Charlie was going in that airplane, I'd burn it up. We finally got away about 6 o'clock in the morning on the 4th of June, 1927. The first 1,000 miles to Newfoundland was through with good weather. The only trouble was we had headwinds. And our tests on Long Island showed that we could fly for 40 hours at 100 miles an hour. Well, on the flight up to Newfoundland, we were only making 70 miles an hour. And 70 miles an hour for 40 hours is 2,800 miles. It was 3,200 to land on the other side, leaving the last 400 to swim. Well, fortunately, the wind shifted after we left Newfoundland, and as you see, we made it.
The unusual engineering accomplishments of our American aeronautical industry began to bear fruit in the late 20s and early 30s. From a military point of view, for the first time, our various types of combat planes were unmatched abroad. Moreover, we found the solid beginning of commercial air transport.
Two famous Army pilots, Carl Tui Spots and Ira Aker, flew 7 days in 1929 without landing.
The question mark flight was an endeavor to use refueling as a means of keeping the plane in the air for a long time. The driving inspiration behind it, I believe, was Ira Aker. The flight did prove that refueling was practical.
General Aker remembers an incident that forecast the need for equipment which would permit blind flying.
In 1919, flying in the Philippines from Manila to Stotzenberg, our station at that time, I ran into a typhoon and the rain was so heavy that I couldn't see the horizon. I fell in a spin, and only the fact that the Manila Bay was yellow and the rain was darker was I able to recover from the spin and fly home. To my surprise, I found for the first time that when you couldn't see, you couldn't fly. I described this to Lieutenant Longfellow, later General Longfellow in the Second World War, and we began some crude experiments by hanging a plumb bob down across the instrument board and by putting a carpenter's level on the longeron, and got so that with these two aids, we could fly through cloud, through several thousand feet of cloud.
10 years after General Aker's Manila experience, Jimmy Doolittle, in association with the Sperry Company, tackled the problem.
I made the first blind flight, the first completely blind flight, taking off under a hood, flying a prescribed course, and landing back under the hood without ever having seen out of the aeroplane. This doesn't sound very important now, but out of that came two instruments, the artificial horizon, the directional gyro, that are today standard equipment on every commercial aeroplane and every combat military airplane.
The Great Depression had come. The industry was hard hit, but nevertheless, new companies developed to meet the increasing complexity of the airplane and its growing use of metals, electronics, and automatic controls. Dutch Kindleberger departed from Douglas to take over North American. Companies were formed bearing the famous names Bell, Fairchild, Northrop, Beech, Cessna. A World War Navy pilot, Leroy Grumman, left civil engineering to enter aviation.
We knew that a conventional airplane
wouldn't get us an order. We finally ended up with the design of the first military fighter with retractable landing gear, for which we got a contract and which proved to be highly successful, having a speed far in excess of any current Army or Navy fighter of that time.
The 30s also were the years in which each summer fierce competition was held to determine the best of the airplane breed. Proof of the individual airplanes, engines, and pilots came in the national air races. With thousands looking on, the legendary pilots raced. Doolittle, Hazlip, Turner, Whitman, Levere, Kulbach, Newman, Fuller, Jacqueline Cochran. And flyers still flew against the clock, across the continent, across the seas, and indeed around the world itself. Falcon, Post, Gatty, Bird, Hughes, Amelia Earhart, and Wrong Way Corrigan. As the hour swung late in the 30s, the air races were curiously American. For in Europe and Asia, aviation was not a case of relatively puny efforts in some, such as America was providing, much of it from individual man and companies. Rather, the vast resources of powerful foreign nations now were thrown behind the construction of air forces designed to subdue the world or to defend against such aggression. In the United States, under the impact of a depression, Congress had scrapped the Morrow Board procurement plan and stopped providing appropriations for 1,800 military airplanes that had been scheduled. On New Year's Day, 1936, the Army Air Corps had only 300 planes fit for war duty. A year later, we had dropped to sixth place among powers in air combat strength, although our industry was judged to be technically at least 18 months ahead of foreign competition. France had squandered a first-rate air power while she sat behind the Maginot Line. The British, too, had let the Axis powers outstrip them. Frantically, both countries turned toward the United States, aware that, in the very act of running hard to meet crisis after crisis, an emphasis had been placed upon research, experiment, and development, which gave the United States technically superior aviation equipment. So the free world turned to the United States. Germany's Luftwaffe had demonstrated that the airplane was a vital weapon of modern offensive war. In the skies above England, the Royal Air Force now demonstrated that the airplane was a vital instrument of modern defensive war. The struggle in Europe shook America. A month after Congress had received a bill providing only 61 combat airplanes for the Army Air Corps for the following year, President Roosevelt called for a long-range production program of 50,000 airplanes. America slowly mobilized its productive capacity. It began to draft its young men. It sought to train them with wooden guns, cardboard tanks, and mock airplanes until it could gear its productive capacity to build the real thing. The war spread. Germany seized Norway, turned on its momentary ally Russia, overran Greece, joined its partner Italy in Africa, and encouraged its Asiatic ally Japan. Nothing could have convinced the people of America more surely of the bitter nature of modern war than the sneak punch that Japan threw at Pearl Harbor. The nation fell to work to expand its token battle forces and its production into a great tide of men and machines. To train men and to equip them required long months, particularly in aviation.
Immediately after the president's pronouncement in 1914, licenses were given to the automotive group largely to assist in the production schedules which lie ahead. Nevertheless, until the end of 1943, the equipment which actually saw service on the various fighting fronts all over the world were furnished entirely by the aeronautical industry. because it was a fact that it required 20 months to 2 years for the average automotive company to begin.
With their momentum at full flood, the Japanese swept through the Pacific. Jimmy Doolittle and a little band of flyers carried the war home to them in a joint Navy-Air Force operation.
I've frequently been asked, what was the purpose and what was the effect of the first Tokyo raid? Well, the purpose was to take the war to Japan, to show them that their island was not inviolate. The effect? Well, the effect was to cause them to divert some of their military strength that was needed in the South Pacific to the protection of the home islands.
Slowly, the nation began to regain control of the air and the sea lanes that it had lost in the Pacific. The first great victory was the Battle of the Coral Sea. Captain Thatch, one of the Navy's ablest flyers and tacticians, remembers that battle and the subsequent Battle of Midway.
In the Battle of the Coral Sea, for example, the dive bombers and torpedo planes and the fighters came in almost simultaneously. But the enemy concentrated on the dive bombers. At the same time, that let the torpedo planes in, and they did most of the damage. On the other hand, in the Battle of Midway later, the enemy fighters concentrated on the torpedo planes, and the dive bombers came in almost unmolested. I could see them coming down like a huge waterfall, and there were particularly no misses. They were the ones that did the job in the Battle of Midway.
From their bases in England, American bombers began to strike at the heart of Germany under the direction of General Spatz.
Strategic bombing was one of the ways of winning the war. And our fighter operations, in a large measure, developed into covering operations for the bombers. In order to do that, we had to have the development that had taken place. Good radio, so the leader of the fighter outfits could not only talk to his own men, but be in communication with the bombers, and in turn get some guidance from ground control stations on the ground by radio. This resulted in a different type of fighting and a different type of operation. But it proved conclusively in World War II that the airplane had developed to such an extent that air warfare became a different war altogether than land and sea warfare.
Wellwood Beale, a member of the team of designers who created the B-17, saw the airplane altered from a defensive to an offensive weapon.
The conception of strategic air bombing was not fully developed at that point. Originally, for instance, the B-17 was built to protect our coast from an invading fleet, and hence it was called a flying fortress. But when we got to England, it was obvious that to use these bombers to the greatest advantage, that we would have to not only get the enemy's supply lines, but the places where he manufactured his military equipment. The British thought it would be easier to do it at night. They'd have much greater chance of success and would be less vulnerable to enemy fighters. And they called their bombing saturation bombing. They dropped large numbers of bombs on a large industrial area. The Americans, however, decided that with the B-17 and the B-24, that they could pinpoint a specific target. For instance, the ball bearing factory at Schweinfurt. They, in order to do the job properly, decided that it should be done at daytime, where their bomb site was the most effective.
At home, the United States had channeled its great energies and its vast technologies to produce in flood the goods of war. And now, with our allies, our integrated sea, land, and air combat team attacked. Thank you.
No one in aviation believes that aviation alone won the war. We do believe that the war might not have been won by ourselves and our allies, except that we had control of the air.
In the war's closing hours, Germany had employed guided missiles brutally, but without decisive effect. Simultaneously, England and Germany had put a few airplanes in the air, powered by a radical new type of engine, the jet turbine.
The jet became really important in aviation. The accumulated engineering know-how that this country had built up with its piston engine equipment suddenly became very much less important. This event was really a great leveler in engineering background and potential for all countries. And we had to start over again to try to regain the supremacy which we had in World War II.
In their march across Germany, Russia had seized Germany's military tools and designs and many of the engineers who were developing the jet. The Russians now increasingly saw the Allied victory in which they had been a partner as largely their own. The Western world was either bled white by the war or demobilized. Russia and its communist allies alone kept their armies intact. Their whole creed was one of force, and they began imposing that force on Poland, Bulgaria, Romania, and Czechoslovakia. Russia's abrupt belligerence forced this country's attention upon the air power we had let melt away. For the third time in little more than a generation, the nation set about building a modern air arm. This one to be shaped around the fantastic speeds the gas turbine engine provided. Then, in 1948, when the Russians sealed off the land corridors leading to Western Berlin, the United States, England, and France countered with a famous Berlin airlift. From their bases outside the Iron Curtain, a steady stream of airplanes flew night and day, supplying West Berlin's 2 million residents with food, fuel, and medicine. Finally, the communists capitulated and reopened the land corridor. Then, they sent their minions into war in Korea. There, the United Nations chose to stand and fight. It was a strange, bitter, circumscribed war. The Air Force's prime striking weapon, its Strategic Air Command, was ruled out of bounds. The first sustained jet combat in history took place in a quadrangle of sky up to 40,000 feet above the Earth, but always south of the Yalu River. Russia sent aloft a first-rate jet fighter, the MiG. Only the Air Force's Sabre from the United Nations array of fighter planes could match it. It was a war in which transport airplanes flew 7,000 miles to deliver materiel and to return sick and wounded men. And it was a war in which the helicopter, with its ability to fly standing still and land anywhere, did a multitude of jobs. Among them, transporting literally thousands of wounded from the battlefield to rear area hospitals for prompt surgical attention. Under the impact of Korea, the nation had begun again to turn out modern aircraft in quantities. Monday Peel, the chairman of the industry's association.
That we as an aircraft industry are at the present time turning out about 14,000 airplanes. At the moment, we are a healthy industry. We have to pour back tremendous amount of funds into research and development, funds that we earn when we make the airplanes. This is a very healthy thing. It creates competition. We want competition.
Modern test pilots who fly at sonic speeds and incredible altitudes take an equally factual view of their calling. Tex Johnston sums up his philosophy after putting the J-57-powered B-52 through its paces.
After 12 years of testing, 10 years in the jet field, involving the first jet airplane to fly in this country, the B-59, first rocket airplane to fly in the United States, the X-1, incidentally the first airplane to fly faster than the speed of sound, the B-47, the B-52, I believe all the more in the two old sayings. First, that one test flight is worth 1,000 expert opinions, and the other one for the flyboys, the altitude above you and runway behind you will never do you any good.
Chuck Yeager, the first man to fly through the sonic barrier, and Bill Bridgman, a test pilot who has flown almost twice the speed of sound and has piloted a plane at an altitude of 79,000 feet, discussed their calling in language peculiarly their own.
Certainly enjoyed the work. I think launching's the only safe way to get into that kind of flying. It's a heck of a lot safer than takeoffs, that's for sure.
Yeah, and you burn so much fuel when you take off before you get up to the altitude where the airplane could drop you. And I personally think that's the most fun involved in a flight is when the guy cuts you loose, you're just hanging there for a minute, just like on a roller coaster.
And so the airplane has evolved from the Wrights, whose first flights at Kitty Hawk were at speeds hardly faster than an athlete can run, to speeds today where the Bridgmans, the Jaegers, and the Johnstons travel faster than a bullet. Horizons far beyond today's achievements still beckon.
Frank P. Long.
Have you flown before?
Yes, I've flown before.
The Big Picture is an official report for the armed forces and the American people. Produced by the Army Pictorial Center. Presented by the Department of the Army in cooperation with this station. The margin of victory in tomorrow's battle could be exactly the distance between the jeeps and the helicopters. Copters don't have to follow roadmaps, don't need bridges to cross rivers. But do move troops more swiftly than ground carriers. In an age of nuclear firepower, mobility is a good defense. But the best defense is a good offense. The fast-moving force is both hard to hit and hard-hitting. Tomorrow's battle lines will be fluid. Tomorrow's battlefield, a crazy quilt of friendly and enemy forces. Force that can concentrate, hit, disperse, hit again, punch men and equipment into the breakthrough will be the irresistible force. To provide the means for such a force is the goal of Army Aviation. United States Army presents The Big Picture, an official report produced for the armed forces and the American people. Now, to show you part of the big picture, here is Sergeant Stuart Queen.
Army aviation is not a branch, not as it once was a corps, not a specialized unit, nor is it simply an adjunct to the artilleryman. Certainly it is not a second Air Force. Army aviation is a way, a means. If you ask what is its purpose, then you must also ask what is the mission of the Army. The purpose of Army aviation is to help the Army achieve its mission. Army aviation is a way of moving men and removing casualties, of funneling supplies forward and information back, of bypassing enemy troops and overpassing adverse terrain. In short, it represents an entirely new, still evolving concept of fighting. The concept's goal is full exploitation of the sheath of air closest to the ground. The rapid, unhampered delivery of an attacking or reconnaissance force concealed in the wrinkles of Earth or behind the nearby horizon. This film speaks for the men and aircraft chosen to do this job. The men are the highly skilled Army aviators. The aircraft are the specialized vehicles designed to accomplish the Army aviation mission.
The story of modern Army aviation begins at Fort Rucker, Alabama, the program's training center. The most significant thing about Fort Rucker is how it has changed. A few years ago, it was an abandoned infantry post, a remnant of World War II. Today, it is one of the most rapidly expanding units in the nation. A new community of homes has appeared in the sunny Alabama countryside. Next to a new complex of airfields. A unique family of aircraft uses the airstrips. Each one is a specialist. Each a winner of the stiffest competition, finally selected after years of research, development, and testing. The Army now has more than 5,000 fixed-wing and rotary-wing aircraft. Instead of referring to the helicopters as a family, we might call them tribes, for their names are Sioux, Iroquois, Chickasaw, Choctaw, Shawnee, Mojave. In some ways, all these copters and airplanes are alike, since they must operate right at the front lines, not from some asphalt base. They all possess the two R's of Army aviation. They're rugged and reliable. The World War II observation plane was the forerunner of today's Army aviation. The aerial observers spotted the target and told the artillery. The bird dog is a direct descendant of that World War II plane with the same mission, fire control. But the L-19, L for liaison, can do other jobs, such as dropping supplies. The bird dog will settle for and on the minimum landing patch. This road might give your teeth a jarring if you went over it on a bicycle or jeep. The L-19 lands in the length of two football fields. Very important when you must use areas not of your own choosing. The speedy Mohawk is much bigger than the bird dog, but doesn't need much more space to operate. This is the new AO-1, Airplane Observation 1. The bug-eye canopy permits a good look all around. The lines of sight of pilot and observer can meet just 36 feet below the plane. The wide-ranging Mohawk can see with all-weather radar and bring back film from cameras in the fuselage. If the Army has to move small teams a great distance within the battle area, it turns to the L-20 Beaver. An hour from now, this unit can be on a job 100 miles away. The ruggedness of the versatile craft can be testified to by bush pilots who fly it the year-round in Alaska and northern Canada. The ever-increasing demands for quick movement mean that more and more men of a ground army must move through the air. The Beaver gives the Army dependable transportation. The Otter is the Beaver's big brother. It may not look like a big plane, but eight troops with all their combat gear can fit into the Otter's belly. Yet the Otter is small and rugged enough to fit into tight, uninviting fields. Note the type of land from which these otters are taking off. But the latest word in Army transport is caribou. The AC-1, C for cargo, carries 3 tons of materiel or 32 troops. Whether moving troops forward or litter patients rearward, the caribou is a key to the Army's quest for large-scale movement by air. Although this is the Army's biggest plane, it takes off in less space than the Hawk. The appearance of the caribou in the air announces a new era for the Army in moving masses of men within the battle area. When a commander and his staff must get places in a hurry, they use the Seminole. In addition to fast transport service, the L-23 is excellent for inspecting combat areas and installations or observing troop columns. This commander will be sitting down to problems at a post 100 miles away in the time it takes a commuter to get to work. But it's the helicopter that gives Army aviation its distinctive character. The chopper, as Army aviators call it, can get in and out of places inaccessible to airplanes. Invaluable for reconnaissance and a host of other duties as military men began to realize during the Korean War. An observation vehicle such as the H-23 Raven can hover, change directions quickly, fly extremely low, take full advantage of terrain. To see and not be seen is an ever more difficult military mission, but with the low-flying copter, it can be accomplished. The Sioux is the other half of the Army's light copter twins. The Sioux served in the Korean War and earned a reputation as a lifesaver. A major element in mortality rates all through history was that badly wounded soldiers often could not be removed from the battlefield in time. That changed with the helicopter. 20,000 casualties were evacuated by copter during the Korean War, and the ratio of wounded who lived jumped dramatically from that of World War II. Pilots reassure an injured man. For a flight in the litter of a helicopter is a strange experience. If need be, the Army aviator will give medical first aid on the spot, one of many specialties he must know. The Sioux can carry one litter on each landing skid and a walking wounded in the co-pilot's seat. Army copters have proved to civilians in peacetime emergencies as well as soldiers in combat, when you're in a tight spot, there is a way out. Sailing into our picture now, the Iroquois, the Army's first helicopter powered by gas turbine engine. Designated HU-1, HU for helicopter utility, the Iroquois is a crackerjack of all trades, frequently serving as an air ambulance for the Medical Service Corps. For the casualties, the ride back is the shortest possible. The Iroquois, sometimes called an aerial hot rod, has just set 7 international speed and climb records. This modern helicopter actually climbs faster than some World War II fighter planes. The Chickasaw can pick up and go with 10 soldiers, whisking this artillery survey team to a new fire control point. As copters get bigger, they need longer rotor blades to bite the air. The Chickasaws measure 53 feet. All Army copters have a vertical tail rotor for stability and for turning. All that is except the Shawnee, the only one with 2 rotors. Those who go by appearances call it the flying banana. Those who know what it does call it the workhorse. Without a copter, it would be virtually impossible to remove this damaged bird dog. But now the plane will fly again another day on its own. When large numbers of troops are involved, the Army relies on the veteran Choctaw. Each Choctaw carries 18 combat-equipped soldiers. The H-34 also can ferry a jeep or howitzer with its sling. Here are combat scenes never acted in any war that has been fought. Here is a new capability to thrust battle units into action. The possibilities are limitless. Troops vaulting ahead to exploit the effects of nuclear weapons. Reinforcements leapfrogging in to bolster a surrounded unit. Attackers materializing where the enemy least expects. The giant Mojave acts in concert. This Goliath can disgorge 3 jeeps or 23 combat troops. The Mojave can move with the fastest helicopters, driven by 2 engines outside the fuselage. This, then, is our cast of vehicles to give the Army unprecedented mobility through the air. For a different look at aerial mobility and maneuverability, let's tune up the fiddles and gather around these Sioux at a square dance. Swing your partners. This was for fun and demonstration. But to make the whirlybird dance takes the touch of adroit masters. Who are they? Army aviators are specially trained officers and warrant officers in infantry, artillery, armor, signal corps, corps of engineers, transportation corps, and medical service corps. Officers from other branches of the Army must request a transfer to one of these 7 branches before they can be considered for flight training. For aviation is part of all but only these 7 branches of the Army. Flight proficiency in fixed or rotary wing craft, or both, earns the Army Aviator's badge. On completing flight training, aviators may go back to their respective branches to resume regular duties, but they commonly are assigned to what is called branch immaterial, that is, performing one of their flying specialties, such as casualty evacuation, wire laying, resupply, road reconnaissance, artillery control. Army aviators, then, are first of all Army officers. They must be able at all times to carry out the duties of their rank and branch of Army, and they must be ready to handle a variety of air assignments. Put another way, much is expected of them, of them and their aircraft, the hardy bird dog, speedy Seminole, sturdy Beaver, the Otter, Sioux, and its companion, Raven, fast-climbing Iroquois, the troop carriers, Chickasaw, Choctaw, the Shawnee, and huge Mojave. This is today's lineup. Now, what lies ahead? The next helicopter to join the Army will be the Chinook, the HC-1. HC for helicopter cargo. Here is an earlier, smaller version. Even so, its value is readily apparent. a Little John missile is quickly rolled out and set up. All it takes is 12 minutes from touchdown to deliver from close range a devastating Sunday punch. This is the later model Chinook, designed to carry up to 33 troops. In addition to carrying more troops, the Chinook will fly farther and faster than any copter the Army now has. The ramp door closes like an enormous whale's mouth. The Chinook will team with the big Caribou plane to do the Army's heavy-duty moving. In the field of surveillance, the Army is aiming for a craft that can pick up and relay information in one operation. The plane's probing radar finds the enemy target. The exact positional information is channeled to the artillery, and in moments, a missile is on its way. The Army now is working on unmanned surveillance systems. More sophisticated models than this Fire Bee target drone will penetrate enemy territory, take pictures by electronic command, then return the film report by parachute. An ideal vehicle from the Army's point of view is one that performs like a helicopter, yet flies like a high-speed airplane. In order to find this hybrid creature, the Army experiments and keeps an open mind. In this craft, ducted air screws act one minute as rotors, the next as propellers. If you're undecided just where to set down, why, there's no rush. This aircraft is classified VTOL for vertical takeoff and landing. Another approach to the same problem. Tilt the whole wing instead of just the air screws. There is an in-between choice on this craft. To set the wings at an angle for short takeoff and landing with a heavier load. Short takeoff and landing are known as STOL. The demands for mobility seem endless, the solutions unlimited. The aerocycle is one proposal for moving the individual soldier on missions such as reconnaissance, for example. Courier needs something light, maneuverable, uncumbersome. This was one manufacturer's answer, and certainly a dream for anyone who delights in carnival rides. On the other hand, the Army has explored the feasibility of using the helicopter as a flying crane. A cardinal principle in the quest for mobility is that anything goes until proven otherwise. Take this convertible, not exactly light as a feather, but it travels on air. It is one of a whole series of so-called ground effect machines, experimental vehicles that generate and glide on a cushion of air. Air cushion vehicles come in all sizes and shapes, but in principle, They all operate like a vacuum cleaner in reverse. This one, you probably guessed, is nicknamed Flying Donut. A more compact model, tested at Princeton's Forrestal Research Center. Like the others, it is limited to the layer of air a few inches above the surface. This one is called the Flying Scooter. And what boy wouldn't like to have this magic scooter parked beside his house? The air car is another ground effect machine the Army has shown an interest in. It can go 60 miles an hour over land or water, ice or snow. All it requires is that the surface be clear and fairly level. The air car is held up by 1/10 of a pound of air pressure per square inch. It is driven and steered by air jetted through side vents. If this avenue of research proves fruitful, we may someday have a tank that doesn't rumble. New vehicles, new weapons combinations need new tactics. The Army now is embodying a new concept, an air task force, completely independent of ground. An entire unit of air-mounted vehicles firing everything from machine guns to missiles. Much remains to perfect this newest method of getting there firstest with the mostest. But it is exactly here that we see the page turning from yesterday to tomorrow. What all this is pointing to someday is a weapon and vehicle designed as one. A device that will fly extremely fast, low, quietly, be highly maneuverable, and fire the ultimate weapon. This isn't fantasy, nor is it necessarily a faithful look at the future, for new discoveries may alter our course. But it is the province of the Army, for the Army must think on three time levels, now, the immediate future, and the distant future, in order to fulfill its task of protecting us. To put these things in greater perspective is Brigadier General Clifton von Kahn, Director of Army Aviation.
At the beginning of this century, combat soldiers had machine guns and fast-firing artillery. Yet they walked into battle just as the Roman legions had done. And there was one defense against the predominance of firepower, to dig in. And World War I was 4 years of trench warfare. Now, under the Germans in World War II, tanks, fighter bombers, mobilized, and airborne troops converted the same basic armaments into the Blitzkrieg. And World War II was a mobile war. Since then, with the atomic bomb and the thermonuclear warhead, firepower has once again gained the ascendancy in military thinking. The counter-response has been for soldiers to disperse and again to dig in. Yet we must remember that our military doctrine and our history has always emphasized that wars can be won only by taking the offensive. Now the challenge to Army aviation is to provide our commanders with the capability for their forces to fight here this morning and 100 miles off this afternoon. And this might be 100 miles in a variety of directions. This challenge means an around-the-clock readiness without being anchored to a stationary supply base. It means air vehicles as rugged and reliable as the Jeep. These aircraft must skim through the nap of the earth to avoid the eyes of enemy soldiers and radar. Our flying soldiers must be able to move three-dimensionally and at a moment's notice and at great speeds in order to give new dimensions to combat. The commander and his men are armed with new options, surprise and threat, as well as attack. The Army ground commander, no longer shackled to earth, is limited only by his imagination. As General Hamilton Howes put it, it's hard to be audacious at the bottom of a foxhole, but in the air, just above the treetops, there lies one of our greatest hopes for victory on the ground.
The Big Picture is an official report for the armed forces and the American people. Produced by the Army Pictorial Center. Presented by the Department of the Army in cooperation with this station.